she'll guide us during this church year, at least for these next several weeks, as we move toward what will become an adopted future, an adapted future as a consequence of this pandemic in which we've been living. And so we're reimagining our future. And so I want to look at a couple passages of scripture over these weeks that help us to reimagine our future. If you have your Bibles, and I know you do, you have that application somewhere near you, I want to take our attention back to where our executive pastor helped us to hear a reflection of the scriptures today from Jeremiah chapter 29. Jeremiah chapter 29, that very familiar passage of scripture that is found in that chapter. You heard it read today. I'll reread it to you. Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11. The Old Testament prophecy of Jeremiah chapter 29, beginning at verse 11. I'm reading from the New International Version of the Holy Word of God, and this is what it says. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. That's enough. Amen. Praise God for His Holy Word. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. For the time that is ours to share together today, I want to talk from the subject, a promised future. A promised future. Permit me to reintroduce you to this group of disillusioned, disheartened, even depressed people who know something about the favor of the Lord, but at the point of the text at which we find them, they are dejected, demoralized, even dehumanized by their certain and current context. These are they known as the children of Israel, who know something about having the hand of God on their lives. They're the chosen people of God, but at the time of our text, they are dealing with a disillusionment, a depression, a disheartened circumstance from which they can get no release. We came in contact with them last Sunday, if you were with us, for these are the same persons about whom Psalm 126 speaks. We met them last week at Psalm 126, where they were pressing their way through the circumstances of their lives. They had to deal with the reality that certain times in life are more frustrating than others. They're more wearying than others. And this is where the people of God find themselves. Not in Psalm 126 today, but the same people are found for us in Jeremiah chapter 29, a disillusioned, disheartened, and depressed band of brothers and sisters who are dealing with what the text calls exile. They're dealing with exile, and God has told them that this exile is going to be an extended exile. They have to be away from their homeland, away from their temple, away from everything near and dear to them for an experience of 70 years. 70 years. They are away from everything near and dear to them, scattered, dispersed, exiled from their homeland, dealing with extended exile. And let me hasten to tell you, my friends, what you already know. Extended exile leads to exhaustion. These people in our text today are dealing with the reality that as a consequence of their extended exile, they are exhausted by their life situation. They're in Babylon. That's not the place where they want to be. They're away from where they want to be. They desire to be in their homeland, Jerusalem. They want to be in Judah, where they can experience the presence of God in a more palpable and powerful way, but they are not there. These are the children of Israel dealing with an extended exile of 70 years, and they're not too dissimilar from the children of God who are scattered all around the world right now, watching me via this worship service video. radio because you can't get to the place where you want to be right now. You're dealing with an extended exile. No, not 70 years, but at this point, we're approaching 7 months, and those months will continue to be counted because we cannot get back to our regular routine. We cannot get back to what is near and dear to us because we're in a space of exile. Brothers and sisters, you already know that is wearying. That is depressing. That is demoralizing. At some points, it turns to delirium because you just don't know how in the world you're going to recover from the situation in which you find yourself. That's where these children of Israel are. They're dealing with the reality that this circumstance has persisted far longer than they ever anticipated. They thought for sure it would be over by now. They thought for certain they'd be back to some semblance of a regular routine by now, but no, they are away and cannot get back. They cannot set their feet in Zion. They cannot set their homeland as the place of their place of comfort and rest. They are in a space where Nebuchadnezzar has the proverbial foot on their necks. They are in Babylon, away from everything near and dear to them, exhausted. And by this time, they think they can come up with a plan that will help them to get back to their place on their own. They decide, oh, it can't be that bad. Maybe we can start pressing our way back. It can't be that bad. Maybe we can start going out on the weekends for just a couple hours. It can't be that bad. Maybe we can return to some semblance of normalcy. But God says, hold up, wait a minute. Don't take matters into your own hands. I understand that you're frustrated right now. I understand that you don't want to go through what you're going through right now. But then here comes Jeremiah chapter 29 at verse 11. And the first two words, shout my socks off, church. Because the first two words of God are, I know. Now that blesses me, even if it doesn't bless you. These people are demoralized, disillusioned. They're depressed. They're dealing with dejection because they cannot do what they want to do. And God opens up God's mouth and through the prophet Jeremiah, he says, listen here, I know what you're going through. I know how bad it is for you right now. I know what you're feeling on the inside, whether you verbalize it or not. I know that dealing with the reality of not being able to get out and be about like you want to is pushing you into a corner you never anticipated. I know that now having to be parent and principal is wearing you out. You never signed up to be principal of your children's school, and there they are with devices in front of them, having to go through a school day in your house while you're trying to work from home, and now you're juggling more balls than you ever anticipated. And God says, I know you're angry because you just did not think that you would ever have to live life like this, wearing a mask everywhere you go. This makes no sense. And God says, I know. I love it because it seems to me, my brothers and sisters, that God is trying to talk his children off the ledge. He's trying to help them understand you don't have to throw in the towel. You don't have to give up. You don't have to wave the white flag of surrender. I know exactly what you're going through, and I got a plan to give you a promised future that's better than what you're dealing with right now. Oh, brothers and sisters, that's the good news of the text, that God says, despite where you are, I know where you're going. Despite what you're going through, I know where you're headed to. And I came today to tell somebody to lift up your head and be encouraged, because the God you serve even knows those unuttered concerns. The God you serve even knows the things that's going on in your mind that you don't want anybody else to know about. The God you serve knows what's happening in your spirit that doesn't seem real spiritual. The God you serve knows how you're going through this circumstance, and he says, listen here, I don't just know, but I got plans for you. I got plans to prosper you, not to harm you, to give you hope and a future. Oh, child of God, you ought to be rejoicing right where you are. If you're in the theater room in your house, you ought to be celebrating God. If you're in your backyard, you ought to be thanking God for his goodness, because God says where you are right now is not the way it's always gonna be. I know. The plans I have for you, declares the Lord, those plans are to prosper you, not to harm you, to give you hope and a future. May I please seek to unpack this text for just a few minutes, because it seems to me that God is up to something in the life of God's people that we ought to take a listen to. We ought to just take a gander at. For if we understand these principles, if we understand this promise of God, we just might live our lives on a whole other level. We just might believe God for even greater things than we believe in God for right now. God says, I know. And may I suggest, brothers and sisters, that if we're going to experience our promised future, I submit that every now and then, even right now, we need to concentrate on the providence of God. We need to concentrate on the providence of God. Somebody say concentrate. Concentrate on the providence of God. God says, listen, I know the plans I have for you, and those plans are to prosper you, not to harm you, to give you hope and a future. I know. I love that word. Hebrew word for know there is yada. Yada is a very intimate understanding. God says, I'm well aware of what you're dealing with. I'm intimately acquainted with what you're going through. I am completely in commiseration with everything that's going on in your life. Nothing that you are dealing with has taken me by surprise. Nothing that you're going through has caught me off guard. As a matter of fact, I was planning some stuff for it even before you got into it. I intended to make sure that you were going to be all right even when things were going a little wrong. I made sure that I made provisions for you on the front side so you could go through on the backside. Oh, brothers and sisters, are you listening to me? The providence of God. It means that God sees before us. God knows exactly what's going on. He sees the end from the beginning, that God was not caught off guard by a pandemic. God was not caught off guard when you had to go home and sit a while. God was not caught off guard when you had to go through what you're going through, even if you had to deal with it in your own body. God knew exactly what was going on. And so today, I submit, instead of concentrating on the problem, we need to concentrate on God's providence. That means we need to concentrate on the God who was working on it before we got in it. We need to concentrate on the God who's got a panacea for it, even when we're dealing with the pain of it. We need to concentrate on a God who's looking out for us, even when we don't know how to look out for ourselves. Oh, he says, I know the plans I have for you. I know the plans I have for you, and I'm going to prosper you, not harm you, give you hope and a future. Can I go old school King James, Pastor JD? Because the old school King James version says, I know the thoughts I think towards you. Those thoughts are of peace and not evil, to give you an expected end. I want you to expect something from me. Oh, thank you, God. Thank you, God. I want you to expect me to take care of you. Expect me to work miracles for you. Expect me to work things out for you. Expect me to keep your head above water. Expect me to pay your bills even when you get laid off. I want you to expect me to work a miracle in this situation. That God is not limited by the circumstances of this situation. God ain't lost none of his power. He's still the great and mighty God that he's always been. He still sits high and he still looks low. That God is still in complete control. And the providence of God looks before us, goes down the way of us, and makes sure that he's working it all out for our good. I know what I'm thinking about you. I know the plans I have for you. I know what I intended for you long before you got in the situation you're in. And I was working on it even when you didn't know I was working on it. I was figuring it out even when you didn't know I was working it out. I was trying to make sure that everything worked out just the way it needed to, even when you didn't have all the answers to your questions. I like this text, Pastor AJ, because the text presents God at a metaphorical picture of a weaver. That word, I know the thoughts I think towards you, that thing, it literally means that God is a weaver, that God is an expert weaver preparing to blow your mind with the masterpiece he's working on. It is the picture, church family, of a weaver who has the picture of the masterpiece in his head, even while he's still working on it. That he doesn't wait to start weaving to figure out what he's weaving. He's weaving it together, but he already sees in his own mind what's going to happen when he gets done. Oh, I love it. I need to encourage somebody listening to me on this Sunday or whatever day you may be watching this little message. You need to understand that while you're waiting, God is weaving. Woo. I need somebody to understand you're sitting there waiting on God to do something, and God is already up to something. He's weaving things together for your good so that once this is all said and done, you will have the testimony that all things weave together for the good of them who love God. Here it is. It is the picture of a weaver who is working. It is the picture of an accountant who has tabulated the budget to make sure that every dime is in place when the final tally has been given, when the invoice has been committed to you. It is God who is working it out for our good. Oh, child of God, I want you to be encouraged by that today. I want you to rest assured that you are not in this by yourself. And so while you're in it, stop focusing on the negative and focus on the positive. And the positive is we've got a God who provides. That's why you haven't lost it completely just yet. You've had some moments. Oh, yeah, you have. That's okay. That's human. But I need you to remember that you have a provider. You got to remember the providence of God is still in your favor. I told you they're disillusioned, they're disheartened, they're even depressed. And at the same time, they got the favor of God on their lives. That, my friends, blesses me. We have to, you and I, have to concentrate on the favor of God, because that favor is committed through his providence, that God always provides for his children. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Let me keep on moving with the message. I do not want to hold you too long, but watch how the text unfolds. Because as you keep on reading the text, Reverend Stephanie, the text seems to suggest that not only must we concentrate on the providence of God, but I submit in the second place that you and I have to activate the plans of God. That you and I have to activate the plans of God. I'm still in your Bible. I haven't left it yet. I just moved from verse 11 all the way back up to verses 4, 5, 6, and 7. Because there's some things that are in there that help us to understand the plan of God for this season of our lives. God says through the prophet Jeremiah, did I tell you that God has sent Jeremiah to write a letter to these people? He's writing from Jerusalem to Babylon. He sends them this letter. It's a text message from Jerusalem. And when he sends it to them, he says, now listen here, don't just sit idly by while you're going through this season. He says, while you're in this season, this is what Jeremiah says, God says. He says, listen here, I want you to build houses and settle down. You ain't going away anytime soon. This is going to be an extended exile. You might be exhausted, so settle yourself on down. Build houses and settle down. Marry and have some children. When your children get grown, let them get married. Let them have some children. He says, I want you to seek the peace of the city. For if the city has peace, you'll have peace as well. I want you to pray for the city so that all y'all can have peace at the same time. He says, I want you to build houses, settle down, marry, have some children. When your children get grown, let them get married, let them have some children. I want you to seek the peace of the city, for if the city has peace, you will have peace as well. He literally says you cannot just sit around twiddling your thumbs while you're in this extended exile. You cannot sit there having your own pity party, a personal pity party, while you're going through this extended exile. Even if you're exhausted, get yourself up and do something with yourself. He says, do not waste this time. Do not waste these moments. Do not think that you have nothing to do. God says, build houses, settle down, marry, have some children. When your children get grown, let them marry, have some children. He says, here it is, increase there. And don't decrease. When you open up the text in verse 1, you'll find out that several people have already died from the children of Israel. Jeremiah writes, watch, to the survivors who are still in exile. Literally suggesting that some have died off, that they are now dying off as a consequence of extended exile. They have been there for an extended period of time, and some of them are dying off. The King James Version calls them the residue of survivors. It's just a few of them left. It's just a few of them around. And God says, while y'all still there, even with as many of you as there are, you need to be doing something with the time that you have. So build some houses and settle down. I want you to marry, have some children. Let the children get married, have some children. Increase there and don't decrease. I want you to make some momentum in this madness you're dealing with. I want you to continue to progress and seek the peace of the city. Because if it has peace, you will have peace. Here's what God says. Be productive and be active even in exile. Be productive and be active even in exile. Listen, I've told you over and over again what my pastor told me, my father in the ministry, Pastor L.K. Curry from Emmanuel Baptist Church, 8301 South Damon Avenue, Chicago, Illinois, 60620. Dr. L.K. Curry was my pastor. He would say to us all the time, listen here, if you can't do what you want to, do what you can. You won't always have things to be laid out the way you want them to. You won't always have circumstances to be just like you want them to be. And so you got to do what you can do, even if you can't do what you want to do. You can't get back to the church right now. You can't get back to life as usual right now. You can't walk out without a mask right now. So since you can't do what you want to, do what you can. He says, I want you to be productive and I want you to be active. What is it that you know you should be doing during this season, but you letting these moments pass you by? What is it that you should be doing while you got a little more extra time, but you're letting this time pass you by? What is it that you should be actively engaged in? What is it that you should be productively doing during this season, but you're allowing these days to slip through your fingers because you're not being productive? You're still in your little personal pity party. It don't make no sense. We got to be like this. I want to do what I want to do, how I want to do it. And you cannot do what you want to do the way you want to do it. And God says you still can do some things. I want you to build houses, and I want you to get married. I want you to have some families. I want you to increase and not decrease. I want you to get stronger and not get weaker. I want you to plant some gardens and eat the fruit thereof. I want you to get in a place where you're living well. I want you to get in a place where you're living well. And then he says, plant gardens, eat the fruit thereof. He says, listen, while you're in this space, plant gardens, eat the fruit thereof. I love the picture that is painted there, because we all know something, many of us do, about the quarantine 15. But he says, plant some gardens and eat the fruit thereof. You start eating right, you lose that quarantine 15. And he says, even while you're away from everything near and dear, start eating right. Take care of yourself. Take care of your stuff. Make sure you're doing right by yourself. Don't allow yourself to decrease. Increase, not in weight. I want you to increase in professionalism. Increase in maturity. Increase in spirituality. Increase in love. Increase in giving. Increase. I want you to increase. I want you to increase. I want you to build a house. Buy a house. At least clean your house. Something. But be productive. Get a trainer. Get a therapist. Talk to somebody about how you acting crazy and thinking crazy. I want you to make yourself better, not worse. I want you to make yourself progress, not regress. You can do something about your situation. Read a book. At least the Bible, read something that's going to make you better. Build yourself up. Do something about it. And then he says, increase in making sure that the city where you have has peace. He says, I want you to be active, not just productive, be active. I want you to be actively engaged in making where you spend your days, where you live, a better place. Actively engaged in making where you live a better place. You're going to be there for a while. It's an extended exile. But even though it's an extended exile, I need you to be active about making your space better. Because if you read verses 8 and 9, there are going to be some people with big titles who tell you it's not as bad as you think. If you read verse 8 and 9, you'll find out there's some people with big titles who tell you it's going to go away after a few days. Matter of fact, they said by the time Easter gets here, it'll be gone. We just finished Labor Day. But by the time Easter gets here, it'll be gone. It's just a few people, and one day it's going to be a miracle. It's just going to pass away. It'll be like a miracle. It's just going to pass away. It's been many months now, and we're still dealing with the same reality. Just ingest some bleach. Drink some bleach. You'll be all right. But your Bible says, verses 8 and 9, they are lying to you. In my name, I'm not making it up. Read your Bible. The word lie is there. They are lying to you. And the Bible says you can't listen to them. You got to listen to what I say. You're going to be there for a while. So be productive and be active. And if you don't believe they're lying, I'll raise up a Bob Woodward. And he'll make sure that you know they're lying so that you know that they knew in January what was showing up in February, March, and April. Here it is. He says, I want you to be active. I want you to make the best of a bad situation. I want you to do something about where you are right now. I know you can't change the circumstance, but you can change yourself in the circumstance. You can make yourself better. Sing a song of praise unto the Lord and change your disposition. Talk to your God and believe him to make a difference in your circumstance. I want you to ensure that you activate the plans of God. Let me close the message. I've held you too long, but watch the text. Text says we not only should concentrate on the providence of God and activate the plans of God, but may I close when I tell you that God is telling us here that we likewise can celebrate the participation of God. We can celebrate the promises of God. We can celebrate the promises of God. I'm right here in your Bible. The participation and promises of God are real clear when you get down to those latter verses of the text, the letter that Jeremiah sends to those exiles. You heard it read. Major read it. He said, listen, I want you to then call on me and I will answer you. I'll be found of you. Seek me, you'll find me when you call upon me with your whole heart. He says, after a while, I'm going to bring you back to the place to which you were from which you were carried away as captives. I'm going to take you back, listen, to Jerusalem and Judah. God says, here's my promise. He starts it in verse 10. He continues it in verses 13 and 14. He says, listen, I know that you've been wondering, was your future ever going to get any better? And God says, here's my promise. That's the word that's used in verse 10. Here's my promise that I'm going to bring you back to Jerusalem and Judah. I'm going to make sure that when you call on me, I will be found of you, because I'm going to hear you when you call. Hallelujah. He says, when you pray, you're going to find out that I'm a prayer hearing and a prayer answering God. He says, here's my promise to you. After all of this is completed, after all of this drama has passed away, after the pandemic has cleared up to the point where you can return to some sense of normalcy, I'm going to take you back to the place you've been away from for so long. I know it's been an extended exile, but I know how to turn that thing around. I know you're exhausted right now, but the eternal is still in control. I know it's bad right now, but trouble, come on, help me preach, don't last always. I know it looks ugly right now, but if you vote, Trump won't last always. I need you to understand that I'm able to turn this thing around. And here it is. Here it is. God says, what you need to do is call on me, pray to me. And although it's not your timetable that I'm working with, if you will align your will with my will, you will see things working out for your good, because I'm weaving it all together. I know the masterpiece that I have planned in my mind. And because you can't understand it, doesn't mean it ain't gonna get done. Oh, okay. Here it is. He says, I know what I'm thinking, and I will bring it to pass. Now, brothers and sisters, what I like about this is that God says that when the time of exile is over, I'm going to bring you back to Jerusalem and Judah. Don't miss it. I said he's going to bring us back to Jerusalem and Judah. And many of you are not rejoicing right now because you may not know what is implied in the words Jerusalem and Judah. He says, I'm going to bring you back from Babylon, your place of exile, to Jerusalem and Judah. Jerusalem is the city of peace. Jerusalem, the city of peace. And Judah is the kingdom of praise. He says, listen here, if you trust me, if you concentrate on me, if you believe in me, at some point in your not too distant future, I promise you, I'm gonna give you peace, and you may as well get ready to give me praise. Now, brothers and sisters, if there's anybody in your house today listening to me and you know that your God keeps his promises, this is a good point in the message to begin to celebrate already the promises of God. God says, my promise to you is that this too shall pass. My promise to you is I know how to turn things around and work them out for your good. My promise is you will not have to live like this always. You're going to increase now, but it's going to get even greater later. And if there's anybody in here who still holds on to the promises of God, I need you to begin to celebrate the fact that God keeps his word. The Bible says that God is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should repent. If he said it, he will do just what he says. And if there's anybody standing on the promises of God, I need you to rejoice right there in your living room and begin to testify that God keeps his promises. I need you to begin to encourage somebody who may be in your family and feeling a little depressed and disillusioned right now. I need you to declare the declaration of the divine that promises will be kept. I will do what I said I was going to do. And when the dust settles and the smoke clears, you will have peace. And if you got any sense, you will give me praise. So for the next few minutes, my brothers and sisters, I need somebody who believes that God is still in control, that Jesus is still the Prince of Peace, and that he's able to give you a shalom that you can't find anywhere else. He's able to keep you in perfect peace if you keep your mind stayed on him. That means concentrate on the providence of God. If there's anybody thinking about your God this day, I need you to go ahead and celebrate the fact that peace shall be yours. He still speaks peace in the midst of a storm. Is there anybody listening to me who can celebrate the fact that God keeps his promises? The Bible says the promises of God are yea and amen. So I need somebody right there where you are to lift both of your hands and shout amen to the promises of God. Shout amen that God is working it out, weaving it together for your good. Shout amen that trouble will not last always. I need somebody to help me close this message. Not just thank God for peace, but if you know you got peace, I dare you to ramp back, open up your mouth, and begin to praise him right where you are. It's not just Jerusalem, it's likewise Judah. And the question is, can you praise him on a promise? I know you ain't seen it yet, I know you ain't got it yet, but if he promised it, you ought to be able to praise him for it. Because if God said it, that settles it. Is there anybody listening to me who can testify? All I need is a word from God. All I need is a promise from God. And right where I am, I'll clap my hands, I'll lift my voice, I'll celebrate God. Because he's worthy, worthy, worthy of all of my praise. I'm done with the message. I've held you too long. But be not dismayed, whate'er betide, God will take. need you to talk back to me. I may not be able to hear you, but if you can hear me, I need somebody to help me encourage some brother, some sister, and tell them he will take care of you. Favor is still on your life. The faithfulness of God is still a part of your reality. Don't just look at the negative. Focus on the positive. Concentrate on God. Lift up your head, Lord have mercy. O ye gates, be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? Just a future. It's a promised future. It's not just your brother, your sister promising this to you. This is the great God of glory who has promised this to you. And he cannot lie. I don't care who else lies to you. God cannot lie. He will keep his word. He will keep his promises. Trouble will not last always. This too is gonna pass. It may take a while. It has taken a while, but we still hold on to God's unchanging hand. And in his own time, according to his own will, he will weave, work all things together for your good. And you'll be delighted. Even if you don't like the process, you'll be delighted with the finished product. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm giving you hope and a future, an expected end. New Revised Standard Version says a future with hope. Yeah, you're not just going to go back to the same old, same old. You're going to go back with your head lifted up, your eyes wide open, believing God for even greater things than God has done in your past. If you believe it, right where you are, celebrate God. Celebrate his promises. Concentrate on his provisions and activate his plans in your life. And you'll be able to say that God is still an awesome, amazing God. And to him be all of the glory. God, in the name of the Lord Jesus, I thank you for your word that is settled in heaven. I thank you that your word will not fail. Heaven and earth may pass away, but your word will never pass away. Thank you for your word that does not return unto you void. You told me to preach it, and I believe that it's accomplishing what you sent it out to accomplish. So in the name of Jesus Christ, will you work on the hearts, the spirits, the minds of your people who are weary, exhausted, almost to the point of delirium. Will you encourage their hearts, build them up in their most holy faith, so they will believe that even as time passes, you hold our times in your hand. And we thank you for the victory that is ours because we are yours. As in the strong and precious name of the Lord Jesus, we pray this prayer with great thanksgiving and expectation. And all of God's people everywhere shouted hallelujah. Let the church say amen.